So let's continue. Okay, so so we saw I moved this kind of general thing over there. So just to remind you, we are in these two corners. So we are talking about privacy with weak sources. And I'm going to show pretty strong negative axis here, even though there will be some reason for hope. But let's get to that. So in particular, what we're going to start with is I'm going to talk about a general framework for showing impossibility result of privacy with weak sources. And so this framework will consist in three steps. So let me do them step by step. So the first step is going to be something which is independent of the particular source of randomness, and it will only depend on the privacy application that we have in mind. Then there will be a second step that will be, you know, something that you do only once. It's a little bit painful, but we'll do it only once. In fact, we will not do it. I will just point you to the paper. And the third step will be something where it will be independent of the application, and it will be the only time where you need to look at your source in question. So it will be like relatively modular treatment. All right, so the first step is going to be the following. It will say that there is no privacy task P under S. So this is an unfortunate conclusion that we are going to reach, and we'll reduce this unfortunate conclusion to something that we call S is expressive. So I'm going to define below the notion of expressivity or expressibility, I don't know, of the source. It's just the names that we came up with that will generically imply for various privacy tasks that unfortunately, if your source of randomness is expressive, it contains enough distributions to do something, which I'll define next, then there is no privacy task. So let's define expressivity here. So we'll say that the source S is T delta expressive if for any two functions f and g from 0, 1 to the n to some domain C, I don't really care what domain is, such that so this function have to be sufficiently different from each other. The way we will formalize it is probability f of x is not equal to g of x has to be at least 2 to the minus t, where x is just comes from the uniform distribution. It implies, and I'll have to define something in a second, it implies there exists x in the source such that the statistical distance between f of x and g of x is at least delta. All right, so let's parse it. It's a very natural definition, but maybe if you haven't seen it, you haven't seen it, but just some notation. There are some parameters t and delta, but roughly speaking, expressivity means that the source is rich enough to separate any sufficiently different functions f and g. So if and g are different on 2 to the minus t fraction of the domain, where t is a parameter of the definition, then there exists a source, a distribution in the source, such that the statistical distance, which I'll define next, between the distribution f of x and g of x is at least delta. So here, maybe as an aside, let me remind you what the statistical distance is. So the statistical distance between the distributions a and b is, there are two equivalent definitions. The first definition is purely mathematical. It's 1 half times sum over all x in 0, 1 to the n of probability A equals x minus probability B equals x. But I like the alternative definition. It's max over all distinguishers D of probability D of A equals 1 minus probability D of B equals 1. All right, let me try to parse it, and maybe I'll draw a picture over here as well. All right, let's see where I want to draw a picture. Okay, I'll draw it over here. So roughly speaking, you have this two, so this is a probability masses. And of course, I mean, this is like 0, 1 to the n that I view it as a line. But roughly speaking, there is one probability distribution. You know, this is a probability distribution over f. And there is another probability distribution over g. Of course, they're discrete. I'm just drawing them like that. So these are all the points. These are all axes belonging to 0, 1 to the n. And this is probability A equals x, and in black is probability B equals x. So if you draw this kind of plot over here, statistical distance is simply half the area in between these two curves. So, and it's not hard to see. So the statistical distance is the sum of these blue parts, which is where the black distribution is above the red distribution. And it's a simple exercise that this is also equal to the sum of green parts, where the other distribution is bigger than the first distribution. So roughly speaking, that's why, well, alternately, it's a half. So essentially, if you look at this sum of these absolute values, this is the sum of green and blue. It's essentially the difference in between two curves. And because the total area, the sum of all probabilities, is equal to 1, you know that the sum of blue is equal to the sum of green. And so this is just kind of a mathematical or, you know, definition. It doesn't tell you maybe much. I mean, intuitively, it says that if the distributions are the same, of course, there is nothing in between. The statistical distance is 0. But from the cryptographic perspective, the statistical distance is the best probability somebody can tell a sample from A from a sample from B. Because think about it. If you're the attacker, what do you do? I assume you get this kind of sample. Are you going to guess? So A, 1 means that I guess it's in A, and 0 means I guess it's in B. So if you're the attacker, you get this point. You'll say, listen, red is above black. Most likely you're going to guess. I mean, this is the best most likely guess. You'll say it's red. And more generally, everywhere in this green region, you will say red. So here, anyway, here you will say red. But on the other hand, in these other things, you will probably say black. So here you will say black because it kind of makes sense, right? So intuitively, if you are the computationally unbounded attacker, the best way if you want to guess if you're given a sample from A or B, you will just, oh, I get a point. If this probability, if A happens with higher probability, probably it's A. If B happens with higher probability, probably it's B. Right? That's why, so, and if you look at it, so this is like either it's equal, so essentially the best distinguishing advantage equals to exactly the blue area, which is also equal to the green area. Did they confuse you completely, or is it just so obvious that, all right. So I assume it's kind of obvious. So anyway, so statistical distance, I mean, either the mathematical definition or kind of cryptographic definition, it just tells you what is the best way that a computationally unbounded attacker tells those two distributions apart. And if the statistical distance is very small, it means you know, there is nothing you can do no matter how unbounded you are. And so let's get back to this kind of definition from this aside. So expressive source means that whenever these two functions are at least not pointwise equal. Of course, if the functions are pointwise equal, there is nothing you can do. But if the functions, there is a non-trivial fraction of the domain where the functions are different, I would like to say that the source is expressive, meaning that, you know, there is a distribution such that you can tell apart f from g on this sample with this kind of probability. So it's a relatively natural definition, maybe not the most friendliest to work with, but we'll make it friendlier in step two. But for now, this is kind of the definition. So just kind of, you know, just to see the example, so assume x is equal to uniform, or the source is equal to the uniform distribution. So the source simply consists of the uniform distribution. In this case, I claim that this source is not very expressive. Well, and it better be not very expressive, because as I told you, if the source is sufficiently expressive, you know, it turns out you cannot do any privacy. So why it's not sufficiently extremely? So like, let's just take, I mean, I don't know, like arbitrary function. Let's say f of x equals x1, and g of x is equal to 1 minus x1, right? So two completely different functions, right? So in this case, what is t? These functions are different with probability 1, right? So t is equal to 0 in this case, right? So these functions are completely different. But if you look on the uniform distribution, what is probability that x1, little x1 is equal to 0, or g of x, which is essentially 1 minus f of x, in this case, it's the same as probability x1 equals to 1, which is equal to a half, you know, because it's, you know, under uniform distribution. So under uniform distribution, probability f of x equal 0 and probability g of x equals to 0, I mean, they're just, you know, a perfect coin flip. So there is no way. So in this case, essentially, this is a uniform bit, and this is a uniform bit. So as distributions, you cannot tell them apart. Right? So uniform distribution just cannot tell them apart, and that's actually the basis of a lot of, like, amazing things, eventually culminating in pseudorandomness and so on, where there are distributions which are, like, you know, that essentially under uniform, you know, uniform distribution is not sufficiently powerful to kind of separate functions which are, like, very, very different, even complementary to each other. Right? For example, you know, jumping ahead, you can have, like, encryptions of 0 and encryptions of 1, completely disjoint support, but under uniform distribution, under one-time pad, you cannot tell them apart. Right? So, but unfortunately, it turns out that if you look at this definition, once the source contains more and more distributions, if the functions are different enough, we should be able to put more and more kind of mass on these different points and eventually start to separate them from each other. All right, so any questions about the definition before I start showing this kind of implication? And you can see for this implication, you know, this is like a general thing. It's a general property of the source. So, you know, when we show this kind of thing, the source will be kind of, will be carrying it along. And the only difference will be for different task P, we will get different T and deltas. Okay? All right, so let me see how to use this definition. So let me give, like, a very simple, you know, kind of lemma. So essentially, I will, you know, so this is like a formalization of this first step. So, so the lemma is, so it will say that if L is T delta expressive, then no, so I'll use in a notation that I didn't define, but it's, like, relatively obvious, no S delta secure privacy task P exists where. So this is just a formalization, right? I told you that if the source is expressive, then it shouldn't be possible to do a certain privacy test. So I'm going to give you a list of how, depending on the privacy test, for which privacy test, we need different levels of expressivity. So so this notation means that, you know, so essentially it means that you cannot come up with a single scheme which is delta secure for any distributions in my source. Right? This is just this, you know, relatively intuitive notation. So let me just start giving you these implications. So for example, for 0 delta expressive, you know, 0 delta expressive and P equals encryption or extra, you know, 1 bit, I guess we can do it even for 1 bit. Because it's an impossibility result, it's already stronger. So if your goal is to encrypt, let's say, generalize one-time pad, to just even encrypt 1 bit, you know, forget about n bits, I just want to encrypt 1 bit. I want to come up with encryption schemes that it's hard to tell apart encryption of 0 from encryption of 1. As long as the source is already 0 delta expressive, which is a pretty weak form of expressivity, it means that it can tell apart functions with completely disjoint support. Then it's impossible. And we have more results. I can list them here, but I'll only show the encryption result just because maybe actually I should copy it from the paper. I might forget. But I think it's like 1 delta expressive and P equals even weak bit commitment. Like for secret sharing, I think I need something like log T delta expressive, and P is I'll explain what it means. T secret sharing, and so on. I will not say it, but there is something for differential privacy. So this, for those of you who don't know differential privacy, something about, it's like a weaker form of privacy, which is usually used in like database security, where you only care about not that, the result, cannot tell any two databases apart, but only any two databases which differ in like in one record or something like that. So the details actually don't matter. So this was actually, by the way, an excuse to write this crypto paper, because that's where the new results were. But really what I liked about it, it kind of unified all those kind of things. But because for differential privacy, we had another crypto paper a couple of years ago where we showed that you can do this differential privacy with Santavasirani sources, while, as we will see from this framework, you wouldn't be able to do traditional like encryption and so on from this Santavasirani sources. And then we kind of showed later an explanation for this. And jumping ahead, the explanation was that in this lemma, as you can see, the numbers are slightly different, because this lemma is usually very simple to prove. We will see it. But there will be like one or two tricks where it will depend on a specific of a privacy application. And depending on those specifics, the bounds become a little bit worse. And turns out the bound for differential, so this is like T equals zero, that's the simplest expressivity. It already rules out encryption and so on. One rules out commitment, something like log T, where T is like a parameter of a secret sharing, how many shares you give rules out secret sharing. Something else will rule out differential privacy. It will turn out that essentially that Santavasirani source is just not, it's expressive enough to rule out these guys, but just somewhere here it's like it wasn't expressive. But roughly speaking, once you get to like weak source and so on, it would even rule out this stuff. Yeah, there was a question?
No, I was just wondering what part of the T is.
It's the number of shares, yes. So for a T secret sharing here, because we're doing possibility results, I'm ruling out the most kind of the weakest form. So here even one bit encryption, just even if I care about encrypting one bit. So for secret sharing, I say, okay, I have a secret, and I split it into T shares. And normally in secret sharing, there are two parameters, number of shares you need to reconstruct and number of shares of which you want privacy. So here I'll push them as far apart as possible because it's a negative result. I say, even if you need all T shares to reconstruct and you require privacy even just for one share, like the weakest kind of most trivial part, even that kind of weakest form would be impossible with the source, provided the source is expressive enough. So I'll give you just a proof, because the proofs are really simple. So this was like the hardest. I'm not even spelling parameters because I don't want to define differential privacy and so on. This was like the hardest. That was like a page in that crypto paper, just because the definition of differential privacy was annoying enough. It had some parameters and so on. But the high-level intuition was very, very simple. So let me give you like a proof of this. It's one of those things where I'll definitely finish the proof over here. Yeah. Oh, yeah, so that was like this step three. You're jumping to step three. So essentially, as we will see, so uniform distribution is not expressive because it's just one thing. So, you can have this kind of thing. But the moment the source, like, weak source, Santavasirani, this source from Bitcoin that I mentioned briefly, for all those sources, I'll tell you actually how to deal with something easier with expressivity. All those things are going to be pretty expressive, so you wouldn't be able to do any of those kind of things. So that will be step three, so I'll come back. I'll give you like a simple example of Santavasirani, how to prove it, but for now I just want to concentrate on step one. So this is kind of this framework, so let me just give you like an example of the proof. And it's really one line, it's just parsing the definition. All right, so let me give you proof of A. And I will concentrate on encryption. All right, let's just understand what it means behind this notation. So let's see which direction I want to go. I want to say that if the sort is expressive, so I say assume on the contrary, or give me any example of encryption scheme or something like that, right? So assume the source is expressive. So assume somebody gives me like a candidate encryption scheme. So let me define given any encryption scheme encdec. Let me define, so I have to define these functions f of x and g of x. And I'll define f of x, and you'll help me with g of x. So f of x is going to be encryption of 0. And so if somebody wants to make a guess what g of x is going to be, encryption of 1. All right. So these are my two functions. You know, the range is arbitrary. I mean, it's whatever the ciphertext space is. I don't really care about it. Could be strings, whatever numbers, never mind. So in this case, what do I know? Well, you know, let's just see if this pair of functions satisfy non-triviality constraint, right? So this generalizes to imperfect decryption, but assume you can decrypt perfectly. So what does it mean you can decrypt perfectly? It means that for any particular secret key, f of x and g of x have to be different. So we know that probability f of x, you know, not equal g of x is equal to 1, which is 2 to the minus 0, right? Because you can decrypt. That's the only thing we use actually about encryption, just the fact that you can decrypt, right? Nothing more. So it's t equals 0. And so let's see. I mean, it doesn't matter in what direction I give you, so I guess I want to let's do a direct thing. So if the source is expressive, it means there exists a particular x, right? So it satisfies, so the source is 0, so here we said the source is 0 delta expressive, so it means there exists x belonging to the source such that statistical distance between encryption x of 0 and encryption x of 1 is greater or equal than delta. Right, that's what expressivity means. So it means that, you know, you can actually tell apart encryption of 0 from encryption of 1, but it means it's not delta secure, right? Because that exactly, you know, this is exactly the definition of information theoretically secure encryption. It means that there is an attacker who can tell encryption of 0 from encryption of 1, right? So this was just kind of pushing quantifiers, but it tells you something, and you can do the same for let's say, extraction. For extraction, so what is f of x? So for extractor, f of x is simply extractor of x, and g of x is a complement. It's like 1 minus extractor of x, for example. Again, they have disjoint support, but because it's like statistically close to uniform, you know, they have to be, close to each other. Right, and for a secret sharing, it's a little bit more complicated, and for differential privacy, it's more complicated, but roughly speaking, for secret sharing, intuitively, we kind of say, listen, there are these t-shares. All together, they determine the message. So I will, you know, essentially, f of x will be one of the shares, but I don't know yet the index of the share. But I'm kind of saying all together, the t-shares, you know, have to be distinct because you can uniquely decode from all t-shares. So roughly speaking, by some kind of averaging, there will be one particular share for one player where they're at least one over t apart. So one over capital T. So I will set for secret sharing, I will set, you know, 1 over t equals 2 to the minus t. In this case, that's why I chose this letter. So again, I will kind of be able to show by simple averaging arguments there exists one share, which is like there is one player such that this probability at least 1 over capital T, the share has to be different. Right? So this is like a relatively simple argument, and the same kind of proof works. So the point is from this proof, one-line proofs, you can see that this is the only thing that depends on the primitive privacy primitive P. So it kind of tells you the heart of what privacy, what, you know. So here you can say, OK, the only thing we care about encryption is uniquely decryptable, and encryption of 0 is close from encryption of 1. For secret sharing, is like all t-shares can reconstruct the message, but no individual share is tells it apart. For differential privacy, it's something else. So it details what kind of, you know, for commitment, it will be, you know, again, commitment of 0 is close to encryption of 1, but there will be some form of binding which will be not unique, but essentially depending on the binding, you know, you have to translate binding into this f of x not equal g of x. Either way, it's really not hard. This is like in the paper, you know, these three are like half a page total, and this one is like one page just because we need to push some quantifiers. Right? And notice we don't need to tell you about Santa Vazirani or K-Vic, it's just a general implication. All right, so any questions about step one? So essentially, it just shows that this notion of expressivity, which is relatively friendly, doesn't talk about cryptography. it immediately rules out. So this is the only place where you connect privacy application with this expressivity. Yeah.
You're only considering information theoretic.
So here I do consider information theoretic, but all the results we are talking about will extend to computational settings. Essentially, you will just need to generalize statistical distance to kind of computational distance. Let me see if there is anything non-trivial. It's just, you know, instead of SD, you will have computational distance with some parameter t. So everything can extends trivially. There is only one place which is in step two, which also extends, but I will need, you know, I will need to make a separate argument why. But yeah, everything that I says, I'm talking about information theoretic. But everything, if you make an analogous computational definition, you just need to change statistical to computational with an extra parameter, what computational. But it's like everything is like, just like here, you carry this L, you just write it, but you don't need to know anything about it. The same, you know, our definitions are kind of friendly enough. They just work for computational as well.
And you can show it for all.
Yeah. For all of them, there are some small subtleties for like zero knowledge, which I didn't put there in our original papers, or some notional simulator. But yeah, essentially, there could be some minor definitional subtleties, but for everything natural, like encryption, commitment, I forgot what the subtlety for zero knowledge is, but we kind of handle it in the paper. Yeah.
Could you say again which paper that's from?
So this paper, this presentation is in the paper at Crypto last year. I think we kind of ambitiously called it Privacy and Imperfect Randomness. So the excuse was to do this results for differential privacy, but really it was like this framework. But it abstracted, a lot of the things were implicit in our previous work, but somehow there we didn't completely kind of separate the detail of like Santa Vazirani and this. I mean, there were bits and pieces, but here by separating them, we also surprisingly improved some of the results in previous papers in a minor way, but still, like shaped on some small factors, in like mean entropy and so on. But yeah, so this is just from last year, believe it or not. And the way it came out, I was teaching actually a class, and just as a way to prepare a class, I saw there was like similarities, and you know, just gave it as a project to the student to say, okay, we are probably repeating the same thing two or three times, so something the same is going on. So, and we just came up with this, and it turned out to be really embarrassingly simple. All right, so let's do step two over here. Yeah, yeah, of course, yeah. X. This is a little x, sorry. This is a definition of the function. So this is, I'm just defining a little function. So it just depends on the primitive at hand, encryption, commitment. So this is just a function. You know, it's no probabilities. A function given x, view x is a secret key and encrypt 0. View g, so this is little x. So here, I guess, this is x sampled from uniform distribution. This is capital X, sorry. So this is
my
just.
My question is whether it makes sense to consider switching the quantifier.
Where?
There exists X and L, so it can depend on F and G.
Of course, X of course depends on F and G. Yeah. So of course, X depends on F and G. This is part of the definition, yeah. I mean, we need to know what F and G is, because if I don't know F and G, of course, I cannot say it. Yeah, X can depend on F and G, in case it wasn't clear. So this is like, so you fix F and G, and then you're saying for any F and G, now they're fixed. If this is holds, then this. So yeah, X depends on F and G. You can write it. OK, all right, so let's do step two, just so that we get here, so I'll try to put it here. Step two is just a slight kind of strengthening, not strengthening, or actually weakening of definition of expressivity. So step two says that expressive. All right, just because I have little space, I'll use horizontal arrow instead of vertical, will show that T delta expressivity follows from T plus 1 delta separability. So So I'll have to define what separability is. So roughly speaking, here we define a notion which is nice to work with applications. So think about like semantic security for encryption. And this is like indistinguishability for encryption. So what qualitatively here, I'm giving you a notion which is not as natural to derive this result, but it will be much easier to get impossibility results from this result. So this is like indistinguishability, and this is semantic security, if you wish. So this notion, so let me define what extractability, expressibility, or separability of the source is. We'll say that L is T delta separable if for all sets G and B of 0, 1 to the n, such that Z is joined, and I'll write it here, the union is at least 2 to the n minus t. So as long as, you know, for any two disjoint sets which are sufficiently large, so together they're at least 2 to the minus t fraction of the domain of the whole universe, again, there exists X belonging in L such that, and here I will even write it instead of, I could write it as a statistical distance, but I write it probability X in G minus probability X belongs to B is at least delta. So roughly speaking, I guess I will not reuse this board, but if you have universe and you have any sets G and B, so roughly speaking, there exists Z disjoint and not too small. Otherwise, of course, if they're too small, you never hit. There exists, again, a source in your, a distribution in your source, which will put significantly more mass over here than over here. I mean, maybe it has like mass over there. But there is like this distribution that with much higher probability is going to get into G than into B. Well, with absolute values, just for symmetry, right? So roughly speaking, we can kind of intuitively separate the sources rich enough to separate any sufficiently large disjoint sets. So this version, intuitively, you can actually even say it formally, this separability is a very special case of expressivity for Boolean functions of disjoint support, essentially, right? Because here I can look at characteristic function of G and characteristic function of B. Right, so they kind of have a disjoint support by assumption, and they will be different, yeah, with probability at least 2 to the minus t, because altogether, you know, they're different with this kind of probability. So this is kind of essentially a special case of expressivity, right? And what we are saying this kind of restricted thing, so more or less, the key thing is just, this is like the main kind of thing. From general range, which was very convenient for encryption and so on, it just says I don't care about ciphertext space, we're kind of reducing to Boolean functions, essentially. And what it causes is only one in terms of like non-triviality. So I just need this kind of things to be, right, so this is will be a little bit, just a marginally harder to prove, we just lose one than this, but it's, you know, the gains are. So is the statement clear or it's confusing? You guys want to observe it? Because I was actually not going to prove it. The proof, I mean, maybe I'll tell you the intuition of the proof. The proof is kind of uses universal hash functions in a cute way. It's not very hard, but it's kind of, it's like a page is done like once. And it kind of reduces, more or less it composes a distinguisher. So we kind of, well, the way to prove it, we have to say that I assume the sources, so separability implies expressiveness or whatever it is. So we have to say that, so if the source is expressive, then, you know, there exists somebody, if the source is separable, it's expressive. So let me see which direction you want to do it. So. Right, if you can separate any guys here, then you can separate any function. And essentially, we kind of argue that to, I'll probably get it wrong if I think offline, but roughly speaking, you just compose, the distinguisher here that expects, the distinguisher here to build a distinguisher here, you just take this thing, applies universal something called the universal hash function to it, and call the distinguisher here, something like that. So I apologize. I'll probably get it wrong because I didn't write it. But it's something that you kind of do once, and it's not that unintuitive. And there is a much simpler version of this you can do by hybrid argument, but then you will lose not a factor of 2, but a factor of log of range size, which is what we did in our original proofs. You know, because, yeah. No, no, because this we don't change. What we change here is, so let's see. Well, because this is also a kind of a statistical distance, but so let me just see if I stated correctly, because I didn't take notes because I was just lazy to read this one page. All right, so let's see. Do we have, all right, I'll spend 1 minute on this. And then, so if, good, so so the sources, I see. So if the source is separable, it is expressive. So yeah, I need to tell you, given any two functions, good. So roughly speaking, we show that to separate any two functions, we take this function, then we have to define the sets G and B. And the way we define it, we'll take this function, we'll compose it as a randomly chosen, you know, kind of universal hash function, but you know, from whatever this range is to 0, 1. And then now we kind of get those two kind of sets, and we can make them disjoint by losing at most a factor like 1/2 or something like that. And then you know, we just directly use the existence of this guy, and we'll argue it works here as well, something like that. So yeah. No, 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 no restrictions. There is only this factor 1/2 which you lose over here. Yeah. It's at least 2 to the n minus t. So at least 2 to the minus t fraction of the whole domain. So it's like a random element will fall into either into G or B with probability at least 2 to the minus t, just like generalizing here. So OK, so let me skip this thing. It's not super deep. But you know, hopefully you see the intuition that this is just kind of a special case and using kind of a one-time trick that we prove once. And it's so this step is independent of both the source and the application. It's a general statement. Is done only once, so that's why I kind of, you know, after we wrote the proof, I forgot about it. So, all right, so let's do step 3, and hopefully then everything will come together. So, what do steps 1 and 2 imply? They really imply that separability implies no privacy tasks, right? For this thing, so let me just give you some very simple, I'll give you like just a couple of very simple examples of separability and, and there is like a, you know, a lemma which exactly proves it. But notice that separability is something which is very concrete and very kind of intuitive. So let's give examples of separability. Let's example 1 will be k weak source. And in fact, I'll even set k to be n minus 1. Just, you know, like this generalization of this one-time pad. Remember, one-time pad with 1-bit entropy deficiency was already bad. So we kind of want to say that you cannot forget about one-type pads. There is no kind of encryption scheme which will tolerate n minus 1 weak source, even if you want to, you know, to just encrypt 1 bit. So let's apply it here. And I'll just do it for t equals 0, but it works for any t. It doesn't really matter. So actually, I guess I can do it for general t. So there are these two sets, g and b. And without loss of generality, let's assume g is greater or equal than b. And also g is so this will be at least 2 to the n minus t minus 1. So you know, G will be a slightly bigger set. So all right, so now I want to pick a distribution which has mean entropy at least n minus 1, and which falls into G with much higher probability than in B. Can somebody tell me how to do this distribution? All right, I'll help you. I'll arbitrarily partition, just draw a line over here such that both of these sets are of size 2 to the n minus 1. All right. I mean, you know, just for any two sets, you know, I'll just, I mean, if G is too big, it's even easier for me. So let's just assume I can do it. All right, so what would be my distribution of mean entropy n minus 1, which will fall in G much with much higher probability than in B? So I'll just make it this uniform here. All right, so I'll just make a uniform distribution here. then probability x belongs to G minus probability x belongs to B is equal to, well, the second probability is 0 because it never belongs to B. And the first is essentially size of G divided by 2 to the n. So this is greater than, size of G divided. So this is greater than, 2 to the t plus 1, I guess. Right, because all together the sizes is 2 to the minus n minus t, so G will be was the bigger guy, so it was at least this side. So I get this. So essentially this means that this is, using this notation, this is t 2 to the t plus 1 separable. I hope I didn't make a mistake, but I'm not sure. But you see, it's like it, in this case, it's like for weak sources, it's totally obvious. You put as much mass as you allowed in one set and completely avoid the other set. Right, you just plug it in, and this is kind of good enough for any of our applications. So you can set, 0, 1 here. So it will be like 0, 1 half separable, for example. So because it's 0, 1 half separable, you cannot have 0, 1 half secure, like encryption or extraction or something like that. So it actually gives you, in a very concrete way, the kind of insecurity that you get over here. Right, and I guess I have the whole table. I'm not sure if I should draw the whole table or not. I think I prepared it here. I guess I can try to draw it, and then let's see if I need. I was going to give you Santavazirani kind of thing. Let's see if I. So is this kind of proof clear? I mean, as I said, I didn't spell out exact parameters, but I just wanted to say that it's like really, really simple, right? Right. The definition. I just look at this definition. Just for any two sets, I need to come up with a distribution that separates them, and it's really, in this case, it's kind of obvious what to do. But for other sources, it's actually kind of trickier. So for example, now I guess I can, I'll erase the expressivity kind of thing, because now that we know separability is all we need. For Santavazirani, it's a little bit cuter, so I will not give you the whole proof. But for Santavazirani, actually, the proof will start similar. So I have these two sets, G and B. And I have to define a distribution. So for the weak source, it was very simple. I'll just put uniform distribution over here. For Santavazirani, remember, I need to have this constraint, probability xi equals 0 condition of essentially x minus. It has to be between 1 minus gamma over 2 and 1 plus gamma over 2. So this is my distribution. So let me define the following distribution x. So this is how I sample from x. So first, let's call this side. Two letters. Let's call it H0 and H1. So this is like these two halves, H0 and H1. So I will say pick a bit B in 0, 1 such that probability B equals 0 is equal 1 plus gamma over 2. So roughly speaking, I'm going to pick a half with, just a slight bias, okay? And then pick uniform x from HB. So I have a very slight bias in picking the half, but then after that I pick a completely uniform element in this domain, right? Let me give you two kind of simpler things. So let's, so there are like two claims. So the claim one is probability x belongs to B, G, minus probability x belongs to B. I don't know. I'll probably mess it up. But it's like, it's roughly speaking gamma times 2 to the minus t, maybe 2 to the minus t over 2 minus 1 or something like that. Because think about it. Essentially, like for this case, let's just think H0 is equal to G and H1 is equal to B, just to ignore this t factor, right? So in this case, roughly speaking, my difference is, am I in H0 or am I in H1? And the difference between these probabilities is exactly gamma, right? So it will be 1 plus gamma. So for t equals 0, is just 1 plus gamma over 2 minus 1 minus gamma over 2, which is exactly gamma, right? So for t equals 0, is just I put a slight bias over this, and you just kind of scale it down by t using like an obvious thing. So is it clear? So this is my distribution for Santavazirani. The distribution is just pick a slightly biased half. and pick a uniform element inside the half. So, and it's very easy to argue that this is going to separate them with this probability. What is harder, and I'm going to leave it as an exercise, X is gamma as V source. So the proof of this is cute, but I'm just going to leave it as an exercise. So this is the only kind of slightly painful thing to argue this source that doesn't look at the bits. It like partitions the space arbitrarily into half and just picks a bias halves. Somehow every particular bit will be only between half plus, you know, half plus minus gamma over 2. Right? So the application will be the Santa Vazirani course is like T gamma times 2 to the minus T expressive. And again, you can plug it in into this kind of thing and get immediate impossibility result. So let me summarize where we are in case I'm too sloppy in my derivations. So the point is everything is really simple. I mean, yes, you need to keep track of this minus T's, but we are under an ambitious task. We want to show that no encryption or commitment is possible with these weak sources. We kind of separated them into like essentially two tasks, not counting the one-time task. And the task is, given a new privacy thing, zero knowledge, encryption, commitment, just understand what kind of expressivity is enough to rule it out. And that looks kind of complicated, but you know, I erased it. It's really usually just a couple of lines proof. After that, you say, instead of expressivity, let's work with separability. And for separability, there you forget about your privacy application. You just kind of see, OK, what's the best way I can separate two sets in my distribution, two sets which are disjoint support. And here, that's the only thing that you need to know about the source. And by that part, you don't really care about your privacy implication. And then you get some number. Like for Santa Vazirani, we get T times this. For weak source, we get like this. There are other sources like that you can look like Bitcoin source. You get something else, you know, similar to this and so on. And then you see, is it what you get? Now you add one, right, because you need to add one because of this plus one. But that doesn't really matter. You know, it's like a minor thing. And now you just plug it in into this theorem, and you see, is it enough or not? So what happened for Santa Vazirani, essentially for weak source, it was very quickly enough to rule out everything for very, very mild parameters, even if mean entropy is like very close to n, like n minus 1 for this 3. For Santa Vazirani, it was good enough to rule out this, just not good enough to rule out that, which led to this crypto paper that we wrote 3 or 4 years ago, giving a very non-trivial, you know, differentially private mechanism using Santa Vazirani. I'm not, you know, unfortunately, because Santa Vazirani is such an unrealistic source, nobody is going to use it because you have to make a lot of assumptions to assume that your real source of randomness is like that. At the time, it was an interesting thing because, you know, we gave you something for which you cannot extract, but you can do differential privacy. But unfortunately, this follow-up kind of work shows once you start making things a little bit more realistic for the parameters that I didn't put here, things become impossible as well. So just the kind of things that you can do, maybe I'll draw them here. So any questions? I was going to draw just an example of the kind of impossibility table that immediately follows by combining this framework. But I'll take questions if people have some higher level concerns. I hope I didn't lose you guys because that was supposed to be cute and painless, but I'm not sure I succeeded. Right, okay, so the kind of things that you do from this, maybe I'll fill like only one or two rows for this table. You can like immediately plug it in like here you can have a table, I guess, you know, so here you can have a source, and here you can have a privacy task P, and the privacy task could be extraction, encryption, commitment, they're all like bit versions, secret sharing. I could put differential privacy, but I didn't define it, so I'm not going to put it. And I'll just give you, so for example, if the source is weak, I'll put a block source. So the block source is even stronger result. So if you have a block source, that's actually a surprising, pretty strong negative result. You know, even if I have a block source with one bit of entropy deficiency, but there are a lot of blocks. You can have a gazillion things. Each of them is like almost uniform with 1 bit of entropy deficiency. There are a lot of them, right? Even in this thing, no matter how many of them, you cannot like do, you cannot have more than like 1/5 encryption and extraction, 1/9 secure secret sharing. So you even get concrete kind of constants, or 1/40+1 secret sharing. So it means that any kind of encryption or whatever secret sharing and so on, there exists an attacker who will distinguish, you know, encryption of 0 from 1 with probability 1/5, or distinguish extracted bit from random with probability 1/5. The same for commitment, for secret sharing, and so on. And you can put like various numbers for Santa Vazirani. For example, Santa Vazirani with bias gamma, you get things like gamma over 2, gamma over 2, gamma over 4, gamma over 2t. And, you know, we had like other sources which I didn't define. But you get like this very particular, you know, quantitative impossibility result, super clean. And they just immediately one line follows from this kind of thing. No, you can't, right? So with block sources, that's actually, that, by the way, was new. So that was new in our work, because people showed, because people didn't do, well, I guess something did follow, because like for differential privacy, for example, this was new. But yes, specific separability result for block sources was a new part of our paper, and was actually super painful to get the right. That was like the longest proof in the paper. It's like a 2-page kind of ugly thing.
I mean, deterministic encryption you can do.
Deterministic encryption from weak sources, no, you cannot.
From block sources?
No, because, sorry. Let me clarify. So there is like collision of terms. So here, this is a secret key. Is from this, so usually for deterministic encryption, there in the traditional setting, the secret key is perfectly uniform, but you assume the messages have some high entropy distribution. They come from a block source. So here I'm saying if the secret key, or more generally local randomness, if everything, the only thing you have is like this block source, you cannot do it. All right? But if local randomness is available or something like that, everything that's like going to be this column that we're going to spend the third part of this tutorial on. So this, I mean, let me just clarify. These are like very theoretical results, hopefully cute, but these are like very theoretical results. They just kind of, these are philosophical results. This says what assumptions about your source of randomness are needed to do cryptography, authentication, and so on. And here we are saying the moment the source is separable, which is essentially the moment the source has enough kind of distributions. Well, I shouldn't say it, because there are pretty powerful sources which are even extractable, from which you can deterministically extract stuff, like two independent sources. That's like this breakthrough recent results that have like better extractions for two independent weak sources. So I want to kind of warn, you know, so as long as you have independence, there are a lot of like results where you can even extract randomness. But the moment you don't have independence, everything becomes kind of separable, expressive. And then impossibility results come in. But I wanted to say that using this very clean framework, we get like very concrete, very simple kind of results that, you know, I was a little bit slow, but yeah, it's in like 1 hour you can present everything from the beginning to the end. Yeah, of course, we didn't see it initially. We had like a Fox paper, then some TCC paper, like two crypto papers, but now we have a clearer picture. So, you know. It took a few years to clarify what's going on, but it's really simple. Okay, so let me tell actually the next thing that I want to tell is this. So coming back to this table, so we did like the first part. We had very strong thing for specific sources. But here still, you know, you can ask this kind of more conceptual philosophical question. So I'm kind of going to raise here. You can say, listen, fine, maybe for this natural to define sources, nothing, you know, privacy is impossible. Extraction is impossible, privacy. So here, by the way, when I do this X, you know, the way kind of the proofs were pretty much the same. As you see, the only thing I changed was the definition of F and G. You know, when I talked about bit encryption and extraction, it was just, you know, I just defined F and G differently, but the proof was exactly the same. So here, for this kind of specific sources, it was really the same kind of proof was going through. But you can ask this kind of more philosophical question. You can say, listen, in general, if I need to do encryption, do I need true randomness to really do encryption? Right? Is it like, it's a philosophical thing, you know, this is a kind of, you know, I can rarely give talks in the departments of philosophy, and I never tried. But I was at this workshop in South Africa where me and David Zuckerman were the only crypto people. The physicists, but there were actually people from the philosophy department, and they asked me questions. So this is the kind of thing that even like philosophers might be, you know, conceivably, you know, interested. They know a little bit about encryption. Just, you know, do you need true randomness? Do you need a word with like perfect randomness, or, you know, or not? And, you know, so I'll tell you about the sequence of results. So I'll write it here. So, and I already started to tell you the same embarrassing story about non-universality of the one-time path followed by the universality of the one-time path. So let me tell you exactly what I mean. So first, in this paper with Joel Spencer in Fox 02, and that was improved by a paper with a student of mine, Bosley, in TCC 07. And this is actually by far the most involved combinatorial argument I've ever you know, was a part of. Maybe it doesn't say much, but for me it was actually kind of, you know, we used like kind of Hall's marriage theorem, this, that, like duality of linear programming. It was like pretty cool kind of thing. I'm not sure if the goal justifies the means, but it was actually pretty involved stuff, what I'm going to tell you. So we constructed a very artificial, but nevertheless valid, n-bit source S, capable of perfectly encrypting, roughly speaking, log n bits. There are some other parameters which I'm not putting here, so I'm just going to put approximate sign. Perfectly encrypting, roughly speaking, log n bits, but where can't, with some constant even bias, can't extract even one bit, let's say one bit. And it's actually, you know, if I put even every epsilon delta, it's not much complicated than what I'm saying here. You know, there is some epsilon or whatever and delta flowing around. But really, qualitatively, what it says, I'm giving you a source, you know, a family of distributions on n bits, so a bunch of distributions. And there exists a single encryption scheme, encryption and decryption scheme, for which no matter what distribution the attacker chooses, this encryption, you know, you can even encrypt up to log n bits, close to log n bits. There, encryptions of any two messages on any one of the distributions in the source are identical. It's like one-time path. Like for one-time path, encryption of every message is like uniform distribution. So here it's the same for, it's like one scheme, any distribution you choose, now you try message 0, message 1, message 2, they always will give you the same distribution as a result. So it's like perfectly secure encryption of log n bits. But now if you try to build an extractor there, for any extractor, even if the extractor can only try to extract only one bit as opposed to log n, I will come up one of those super sneaky, annoying distributions in the source that will tell apart, which will be able to distinguish extractor of 0 from extractor of 1. No, okay, so this is a, okay, let me just clarify. So this is a counterexample. So I'm defining, oh, I see, so you're saying why it's not, because it's, you know, it's uniform over, but, you know, the domain keeps changing. So for every particular distribution, there exists a different kind of domain where the ciphertext will be uniform in this subset of ciphertext. For the other distribution, it's this. So roughly speaking, just because you're saying, listen, I mean, I already advertised that this was like a hard proof. I mean, I could actually even, but let me not give you, because I'll concentrate on the converse kind of thing. But just to give you a little bit to demystify this, so what we did there, instead of proving this, what we did, I started with defining an encryption scheme. An encryption scheme was actually universal encryption. Encryption scheme was kind of saying that, you know, essentially for any k tuples of, for any like little, you know, for any little n tuples of ciphertext, distinct ciphertext, there was a key which produced this ciphertext for this message. So I looked at essentially complete kind of vanilla generic encryption scheme where everything is possible. And then I defined my source to be like artificially all distributions for which this encryption is perfectly secure. So just in case you're saying, how did you do it? I said, well, I started with encryption, and then I tautologously set my sources, all distributions for which this encryption is secure. So this way I handled perfectly encrypting enough bits. The question is why this is non-extractable. Why can't you extract even one bit statistically close to uniform? And there we needed to understand a lot of kind of things and use duality of linear programming and all kinds of things. So in everything that I was going to say, this is by far the deepest result, but probably nobody ever read it and nobody will ever read it, but it was fun working on it. Good. So you actually reminded me, I'll answer this question in a second. For that question, somebody kind of asked me before about efficient simplability. I see. So the question was about efficiently for this kind of examples. So is the source, I guess, which will contradict. So this source, yes, there were a lot of distributions of this source which are not efficiently sampleable. So this could be a weakness and conceivably, it's actually would be interesting if you can extend it. Of course, once the source is efficiently sampleable for various parameters, this source is deterministically extractable. So in some sense, it cannot be too efficiently sampleable because a subfamily of efficiently sampleable sources is like not large enough compared to all possible sources. So that family is known to be extractable with some at least parameters. So in some sense, the answer is yes. For this result, it's definitely the way distributions which were not efficiently sampleable and for a good reason. Right, but I'm saying that's impossible to achieve because the family, there is a result that we'll see like 5 minutes in a different context that if your source contains not too many distributions, but not too many is like single exponential as opposed to double exponential number of distributions, this source is deterministically extractable. And efficiently sampleable distributions, there are not enough circuits. There is only a single exponential number of circuits like on n bits. So this source is deterministically extractable. And there are papers that studied it, which I'm not going to talk about. But yeah, it's necessarily some of it is non-efficiently sampleable. But for this impossibility result, this is a great question. So in fact, for this impossibility result, the way we show that the source is not separable, very often the distributions that I just erased, they were not necessarily efficiently sampleable. And there was a whole paper at Crypto of like Rafael Pass and I think his postdocs, which at least for Santa Vazirani, they showed very non-trivially using some Fourier analysis stuff how to extend our impossibility results to efficiently sampleable sources. But for other sources, it's kind of hairy. So there is something open there. But as I said, if the source is too efficiently sampleable, there is some deterministic extraction. So there are some caveats. But yeah, there is a little bit of room to improve this kind of results. I don't think you can improve this result. In this setting. So this was kind of somewhat technical, but at least this gave us hope. We call it an universality of the one-time pad. It kind of gave us hope that maybe at least inherently, yes, maybe for all natural sources, you cannot do both, but at least conceptually it would be interesting. If there is a separation, there is a little bit of separation. But then unfortunately, there was a second part of this paper which I will prove in its entirety to you, and this is by far probably the more important result, even though it's much simpler to prove. So this is a second result, which is the unfortunate negative result. So the unfortunate negative result is the following. If S on n bits is capable of encrypting B bits, it will be necessarily that B will have to be greater than log n. You will see why. Of B bits, then you can deterministically extract, roughly speaking, B minus log n bits from S. All right, so this is like a pretty general kind of result that hopefully once you see the proof will teach us something about relationship between encryption and extraction. And to a large extent, it says, yes, there is a little bit of a gap in terms of the number of bits you can encrypt and extract. But roughly speaking, usually we want to encrypt more than like log n bits because, for you know, once, you know, if you want to encrypt more than 200 bits, then n will be more than 2 to the 200, which is the number of molecules in the universe or something. So for all interesting setting, as long as in our lifetime we want to encrypt more than 100 bits, essentially it just says that you must have true randomness in the world. Or you must have something which is, if it's not true randomness, but you can just deterministically extract true randomness, at least one bit, or in fact, almost as many bits as you need. So in some sense, this result says that one time pair is almost universal. Maybe you lose. So if you can do encryption at all, you might as well first extract b minus log n bits, and then you might as well use one-time pad. You lose like log n bits. But in some sense, you know, one-time pad is almost a universal encryption scheme in this sense. So any question about the statement, then the proof will be surprisingly non-complex of this statement, so, and its philosophical implications. All right, so let's try to do the proof. And maybe I'll mention, before the proof, in case I run out of time, so let me just shelve it for a second and tell you a little bit about some other results. There is another paper with, I think, Krzysztof, which doesn't get any citations because it's super esoteric, but because, you know, who is to cite it if not me, so I'll mention it here. So here we kind of extended this result in DSO2 because we asked the following question, and this kind of leads me to one of my favorite open questions. So let me tell you this result and then the open question, which I really, really would love one of you to solve. It's, I keep giving it to every new postdoc, and they try for the month, and they say it's too hard. So. But I think it would be cool. I would really appreciate it. All right. So what is the result? So we can see the following kind of trivial implications. So if you can extract, you can encrypt. And if you can encrypt, you can easily do 2 out of 2 secret sharing. How? Well, first of all, extraction from encryption, this is one-time pad. So if you can extract 15 bits, you can encrypt 15 bits by one-time pad. If you can encrypt 15 bits, you can do a secret sharing scheme 2 out of 2, where the left share is equal to the key, and right share is equal to what? So one thing is a key, and you know, so we assume that we can do a secure encryption. So what would be the second share? Just to make sure I still have somebody following. Not the message. So the message is, there is a message. I want to secret share the message. And I want to give you 2 shares such that neither share gives you any information or almost any information about the message. Ciphertext, right? So the left share is a key and the right share is a ciphertext. Right, so in general, if I can do encryption, at least in the 2 out of 2 regime, I can do 2 out of 2 secret sharing scheme, like very naturally. So here, the result of DSO2. So unfortunately, you know, this result, the result over here, to a large extent, shows that the converse is also true. Unfortunately, if you can encrypt, then you can extract almost, you know, the same number of bits. So this is actually not the open question, but I'll just mention, what about this implication? So definitely, the reverse implication is open. I don't know if it's true. So in fact, so let me tell you what is known. What is known here, we have a separation for one bit. So here, we show non-implication for one bit. So with Krzysztof and Bartosz, what we did, we gave again a super artificial source, which allows you to do a perfect 2 out of 2 secret sharing on one bit, but you cannot do encryption on one bit. So super esoteric, it was like a lot of like little plots in that paper. But so at least in the one bit case, similar to this, or in a small number of bits, there is at least a little bit of a gap between encryption and secret sharing. What about like longer messages? We don't know. But in particular, instead of like looking at to here, because maybe this is a little bit esoteric because encryption and secret sharing, I think this thing is very interesting. So the open thing is extend BD07 to 2 out of 2 secret sharing. So this is one of my favorite open problems. So namely, so here we said if you have a source of randomness capable to do encryption, it's extractable. Here I'm asking if there is a source which is capable to do secret sharing, which is another fundamental primitive, which, you know, which is enough to kind of split the secret among two people, does it mean that somehow, so I'm the dealer, right? So I have my message, I have some imperfect source, and I can produce these two shares that I give to two people. So the question is, does it mean that I can just deterministically extract some kind of one-time pad and therefore do trivial, you know, trivial secret sharing? So the proof that I'll show you somehow, you know, unlike this framework where encryption, commitment, all those things kind of trivially, you know, it's just like minor epsilon tweaks in the proof, there will be something fundamental that only works for encryption and also commitment, but not for secret sharing schemes. So we will see it in the next 10 minutes. What it is, so this is one of my favorite kind of philosophical open questions in the area, not because it's practically important for like Intel RNG or anything like that, but you know, just philosophically it's an interesting thing because for this kind of line of work, for when we talk about natural sources of randomness, we saw that essentially for natural sources, nothing is possible in privacy. And the proofs were like really kind of very simple. It's just like the first step changed like by epsilon. And here the question is it true that in general, if you can do a primitive, it implies that you need true randomness? For encryption, we say the answer is more or less yes, modulo this log n gap. But for secret sharing, it's open, and I'm really fascinating. I wouldn't bet anything because, you know, right now I'm literally 50-50. It's like, depending on the day, I think the answer is yes or no, I don't know. It's like, the proofs kind of almost work. Okay, so let me tell you, all right, unless there are questions, let me tell you this because I think this is cute and we'll see how much time we have for, you know, yeah. You mean like here?
Yeah.
Oh, you mean different thresholds of secret sharing? Yeah, I haven't thought about it too much. I kind of filled out of two is the most fundamental. So the short answer is I haven't thought about it in any sufficiently deep detail just because I feel like this is you know, the simplest secret sharing which is possible. There is a tiny open question here, I guess. You know, like here, we kind of showed tight in the regime 1 versus log n, but in general, do we need to lose this log n for general b? I also don't know. But I feel like this is a little bit also less important because qualitatively, you know, for large enough b, if b is like, you know, square root of n or something like that, this doesn't really matter. So yeah, so this is like one of my favorite open questions, and hopefully once you see the proof, you will see that it's something elegant that we should be able to solve. All right, so let me give you the proof. We are back to BD07. But yeah, feel free to ask philosophical questions and or non-philosophical or questions, you know. Okay, so let's see what we are doing. We are kind of trying to argue that, so I need to argue that if the source is capable of encrypting, I need to build you an extractor, right? I want to build a deterministic extractor. So this is a proof. So I'll prove it in kind of three steps, but first I need to define what the extractor is. So this is my extractor, it lacks lowercase x, it's just a deterministic function. And I have to define extractor in terms of an encryption scheme, right? I have a hypothetical encryption scheme, which is great, and I need to show how to extract just, you know, for now just one bit. Well, actually, we'll extract even more than one bit, b minus log n bits, but okay? All right, so I will not unfortunately completely solve it in one shot. I'll reduce it to a simpler extractor. I'll call it extractor prime. But this extractor prime will be applied to encryption of zero. So this is the form of my extractor. And we'll need to figure out what do we need from extractor prime in a second. All right? So is it clear what I'm doing? So this is the kind of extractor that I'm going to define. OK, so let's see what do I need from this extractor prime, and let me actually, to show what I need from extractor prime, let's try to do the proof, and let's try to see where we are stuck, and that will make it clear what extractor prime I need, okay? All right, so take any capital X in your source L, all right? And, well, what is extractor of capital X? Well, by definition, I guess I just wasted a line. All right, let me not waste a line, let me move above. So I'll just replace lowercase x by capital X. All right, and here I have capital X of 0, okay? All right. So now I should probably use security of my encryption scheme. So what a security of my encryption scheme says? It says that for any distribution in the source, encryption of 0 looks like encryption of any other message, right? Well, what message should I choose?
Random.
Very good. Because listen, I'm trying to extract randomness. So I'm trying to inject randomness. And here, this is a deterministic function. But so this is approximately, and you know, there is a particular parameter which is like delta security of encryption, but I'm just not going to do it. This is approximately equal to extract f prime encryption x of uniform distribution on b bits. Okay? So here I'm kind of injected randomness for free, even though my extractor was deterministic. I injected perfect randomness from the security of encryption. Right? Okay. So now I'm almost done. Now I claim that I'm not going to use anything over here. So I'll say that this is extractor prime applied to, I'll be a little bit informal, but I'll write convex combination. So I'm just giving you effectively what I'm doing. I'm now giving you this key X for free. I'm saying, listen, your distinguisher, you're trying to distinguish this from random, you know, just to make your life easier, but it's not going to help you. Now I'm just actually going to give you this, my secret key for free, but I'm not going to tell you the message. So, you know, my message will be my randomness. All right? So by giving it for free, effectively, this is, you know, irrespective of what it comes, this is convex combination of essentially things of the form encryption of little x of ub, where little x, you know, is, you know, ranges through all possible keys. So, I mean, it doesn't matter what it is, but roughly speaking, this distribution will be convex combination of this distribution. How, well, what is the convex combination? Exactly the distribution capital X in question. So now, what is sufficient for me to argue that this is u of b prime? Well, b prime happens to be b minus log n, but, you know. So all I need to do, so it's enough to show that extractor prime is a good extractor for the following family. For the family of encryption of x of ub, where x ranges 0, 1 to the n. Is it clear? So let me just put it in the box. So I claim that if my extractor prime, which I haven't defined yet, is good for extracting randomness for all of these 2 to the n distributions, then obviously it will be good enough for any convex combination of them. And here I don't even know which convex combination. I mean, I only know it in the, but I'm saying even if I knew x, it would be good enough. Because even if I tell you x for free, irrespective of what little x is, if it's a good extractor, I'm in good shape. All right, so any questions? So I reduce, so what did I achieve? I need to build this extractor for some, you know, source which has gazillion of distributions about which I don't know much. And I reduce it to an extractor for only n equals 2 to the n distributions. And the distributions have even a special form, the encryptions of a uniform message under a fixed key. Right? And now, intuitively, I better use something about encryption. So far, I haven't used anything about encryption. Well, I used security, but I didn't use correctness. I didn't use anything about encryption. So we must use it somewhere. So this will be in the construction of X prime, right? Right? Are you guys still with me somewhat? So I kind of showed, you know, I'm trying to, I mean, this is kind of important. I'm philosophically trying to show why encryption implies extraction. And the reason is, we don't see the final argument yet, but the reason is that security of encryption implies that essentially to build an extractor for encryption, I only need to build an extractor for these 2 to the n distributions of this form. So let's look at this distribution closely and any one of those distributions. So if you look at encryption x of 0, encryption x of 2 to the b minus 1, you know, is there anything I know about these 2 to the b points? They're disjoint. They're all distinct. Why? Because you should be able to decrypt. If you have a fixed secret key, you should be able to decrypt. So it means they're all distinct, right? So in particular, what it means, what does it tell me about mean entropy of encryption of little x of ub? So if I actually choose a message at random, and I get those things, I get uniform distribution about around this B disjoint guy, two to the B disjoint guys. So what does it tell me about mean entropy? Well, it's actually equal to B. I mean, it's, you know, there are no collisions, right? That's the only thing I need to use about encryption here. So we're almost there. So now, essentially, what I need to do, I'll rephrase it over here. So it's enough. So I'm going to make a weaker conclusion here. So instead of like worrying about this distribution, I'll write it here. It's enough to get a good extractor for n distributions of, you know, let's call it even y1, yn of h infinity greater or equals than b each. So this is all. So now the question is it true? And now I'm not going to use anything more about the encryption scheme. So now the remaining question is it true that if I don't have too many, only in quotes, a single exponential number of distributions of high mean entropy, all the distributions have mean entropy at least b, right? So I have a bounded number of distributions. All of them have mean entropy. Can I find an extractor which is simultaneously good for all of them? Well, and anybody wants to make a guess? The answer is yes or no. It's Boolean, so you'll be. Well, that's so I guess you did more than make a guess. You gave a proof with this result, or almost a proof. So the answer is yes, and that's actually one of those general things, which kind of, I mean, hopefully teach you something. We see in each step we kind of use different things. We didn't need to use everything. So here we just use privacy of encryption. Here, correctness of encryption is only needed to argue that it's mean entropy. And now, here is a very general fact. I'll write it. All right, I'll test my bending abilities, and I'll put a lemma. So this lemma it's in a different format. It's true for Trevisan and Vadan, but I kind of use it in my PhD thesis as well. Sorry, it's 99. So this is from my thesis, but it's really kind of a restatement of this beautiful paper of Trevisan and Vadan. So speaking of which, by the way, this is, you know, you asked about efficiently samplable distribution. So Trevisan and Vadan shows that if the source is efficiently samplable, you could in principle deterministically extract it, and then they, under various complexity, conjectures or assumptions, build an extractor. But really the thing was just a counting argument. And the only thing they said, listen, there are not that many efficiently samplable distributions. They didn't really use anything else about efficient samplability. So really what this fact and this lemma is, it says that for any n distributions of h infinity greater or equal b each, there exists extractor prime capable of extracting approximately b minus log n bits. Okay? So single log of little n became double log of capital N, but, you know, because n is 2 root n. So that obviously implies what we need to show. And of course, the answer is y. And here is the thing, let's assume capital N is equal to 1. I assume I have one distribution of mean entropy b each. So this is the first question, just to make sure. Is this thing deterministically extractable? Because actually that should be something that we asked like a long time ago. If I have only one distribution, can I just deterministically extract it? There is like, of course, the answer is like you can do it by random function, but we can even do it like explicitly. So this is 0 and 1. So pretend, so here we can just greedily start putting things. So it's like we have something with some probability p of x. We put it here. So p of x1, p of x2. We can pretend that there are these two bins. And we always put the next thing in the lightest bin. So they will kind of keep growing like that. So at the end, both of them will be approximately 1/2. And the gap will be at most like 2 to the minus b. So this is just to convince yourself without like using like Chernov bounds or anything. If I have only one distribution that I know in principle, it is deterministically extractable, ignoring questions of efficiency. I can always just keep, you know, having these two bins or possibly more bins, and I can just keep throwing the next probability point in the smallest thing. And because they're all 2 to the minus b, essentially all those things will be eventually roughly equal. Right? I just kind of do it. So this is kind of you know, a little bit crazy but convincing proof that deterministic extractors for one distribution exists. If you want to make it a little bit more efficient, there is a famous thing called leftover hash lemma that we are going to talk about later, which kind of says, you know, you can just pick, well, the next efficiency thing was like you can just choose an extractor at random and do some kind of simple concentration inequality that it's good. And, you know, if you want to de-randomize it, you can pick it from a family of pairwise independent hash functions. So we are going to hear, actually, even I will mention it in the next trimester of this tutorial. So stay tuned. So in this case, it's essentially one way to prove it is just pick x at random. So what does it mean, pick at random? You can say, wait a second. Don't we have this no randomness and so on? Listen, I'm just talking about the existence result, not efficient computability. I'll extend efficient computability next in the next 2 minutes. But here I just want to argue it exists. And I'm saying if you pick a random function and fix it, with very high probability, it's going to be a good extractor for any one distribution. But the probability is going to be so low that you can just take a union bound as long as there are not too many of them. And it turns out if you plug in standard Chernoff bounds, there is absolutely nothing deep, you get these numbers. And the next question is what Travis and Vadan did. They said, do I need full independence? Do I need a completely random function? And it turns out, this is a nice kind of thing, approximately log n-wise independence is enough. So what does that mean? It means that instead of choosing an extractor from at random from a family of all possible functions from n bits to b prime bits, or not n bits in this case, is whatever the ciphertext size is, we just pick it from a family of, you know, bounded-wise independent hash functions. Not pairwise, unfortunately, but log of capital N-wise. And the point is, so this turns out to be enough. Like pairwise independence is not enough. It's enough for one distribution. It's not enough for this many distributions. But this wise is enough. And in our case, this log of n is equal to little n. And little n is the size of our secret key, so it's polynomial. So in particular, it means that, you know, as long as I have an n-wise independent family of functions, every single one of them is efficient, and we have it. It's like polynomials of degree n and so on. It means that there exists even an efficient extractor. So in particular, there exists, I can even put the word efficient here. And even I can even efficiently choose it, just a random function from a family of n-wise independent hash functions with very high probability is going to be good. And because all of them are efficient, sorry.
How do you choose the keys for the pairwise
independent? So truly random. Yes, of course, if I don't have true randomness, but what I'm saying is, I mean, it's just to argue existence, that's my way to showing existence. You know, if some mathematician maybe comes in, maybe they can just say for this particular key, here I'm showing existence. You're right, it could be a weakness of this result. That's why Travis and Vanan didn't stop here. They actually de-randomized it. That's what they did, but under particular complexity assumptions about polynomial hierarchy, you don't want to know. Stuff like that, they kind of de-randomize it in some sense. But just to show existence, yes, I will choose it truly at random, but it's done only once. It's not like, you know, once I do it once, with high probability, if I have true randomness somewhere in Australia, and they're just nice enough to do it once for me, or they'll just do it once for me, I'll import it here to the world of not true randomness, and, you know, with only Vikrams, and it's going to be good enough. So yes, there are some caveats. Nothing comes like completely for free. But at least in terms of existence, we are good. And in fact, it's even going to be efficient. And even efficiently sampleable, it's just not going to be necessarily explicit. You know, there are all those words, explicit, efficiently sampleable. We get all of them except for explicit. So in particular, what it tells you, coming back to this application, look at this thing. If this guy is efficient, I mean, as long as encryption scheme is efficient, we get efficient extractor as well. So in particular, at least on the existence result, here, for any L capable of, if you put the word, I'll put it in a different color. If I put the word efficient here, I can put efficient here as well, at least in terms of existential kind of thing. So here we can even, well, in some sense, preserve efficiency. Essentially, we'll just encrypt zero and apply like a polynomial of degree n. Which polynomial, I don't know, but I can tell you majority of polynomials will be good enough or something like that. So also let me see. So I think soon we should take a break. So let me just conclude this, essentially just maybe telling you the transition points and, of course, taking questions. So there is one more result that I'll mention maybe over here. So this is always a really great question, so feel free to talk to me about it. I would love somebody to work on it. We did have a partial result here. So this is from the same crypto paper. It was like a little section of that paper. So what we showed is some kind of a partial resolution here, saying most privacy tasks P under S, including secret sharing. Actually, because it's an extension of this paper, everything which was like expressive and so on. So all the tasks which our theorem, which was on one of these boards, was true. Remember when we did this kind of thing? So we kind of had an extension. So for almost everything, including secret sharing and so on, it implies. So if there is a source of randomness which can do, let's say, 2 out of 2 secret sharing, or encryption, or commitment, or whatever, then, or differential privacy, it implies weak 1-bit extractor. So what do I mean by weak? So one limitation is 1-bit. Here we have multi-bits, so that's one weakening. But of course, even for 1-bit, because it works for secret sharing, I would be happy. The problem is the weak part, so you can judge if you like this result or not. So essentially, the extractor outputs 0, 1, or bottom. So it could fail. It could say, you know what? It says, listen, here I'm confident I should extract 0. Here I'm confident I extract 1. But if something fishy is going on, I'll just fail. I will output bottom, meaning, something is wrong with the source. And you say, well, let's just output bottom all the time. That will be great. So probability extractor equals 0 is very close to probability extractor equals 1. So this is good. So it means as long as you don't output bottom, the bit is unbiased, as we want. But of course, what prevents us from outputting bottom all the time, making it trivial, at least probability output bottom on uniform distribution is noticeably greater than 0. I mean, there are some parameters. But roughly speaking, for encryption, it will be like 1/2 or something like that. Probability output non-bottom. Probability, so essentially, at least on the uniform, so it's not going to be like a pathological thing. At least if you feed it uniform distribution, with some non-trivial probability, for encryption is 1/2, for commitment is like 1/4, for secret sharing is something smaller. But it's non-negligible probability, so with non-negligible probability, it will actually output something, at least on the uniform distribution. And when it outputs something, is awesome. But unfortunately, it might kind of fail.
Does that mean it only extracts from uniform distribution?
Well, no. Whenever it extracts, but you're right, it's a weak result. So, it was like a small section of the paper. It leaves the following possibilities, that it only extracts from one uniform distribution and fail on everything else, but it cannot completely do it because the distribution is very close to uniform. There it cannot flip a switch. It just takes a bit strings, right? It cannot flip a switch. So for most distribution, which I kind of intuitively am making it informal, sufficiently close to uniform, it will not fail. We have a particular form of the extractor, which I'm not going to tell you. Unless you ask me, it's not that long. But there is a particular form of this extractor. So it's a weak result. It's just, even aside from these things, the fact that it doesn't, I would love to say that it fails with probability 1/2, but on every distribution, it succeeds with probability at least 1/2. Here, I cannot say it, and unfortunately, it's impossible. So this result, which I just erased, but this result of DSO2, if you actually look at that counterexample there more closely, there we have something where essentially replacing this by any x is just impossible. It gives a counterexample there. So this is, in some sense, for this level of generality, the stronger the result we can hope to achieve. But it implies even for secret sharing and so on. So, but yeah, definitely the big question still remains here. No, 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 we just defined it. I mean, because we could prove it. Sorry? Which one? Oh, so my paper in Dodis Spencer, it's like it didn't look at this kind of one-bit extractor, but there is a remark in that paper that if you look at something that that paper does, you know, that one of those counterexample, it shows something where, I mean, it gives you a source where even this weak one-bit extraction is impossible, in provided you want non-triviality on any source. It's like that is, unfortunately, we show is impossible, at least for this particular counterexample. Maybe there is a way around it, but yeah, so you can judge, but at least something for secret sharing, we do know at least something non-trivial. You know, but the main question for secret sharing still kind of remains. So before taking questions, let me just, so yeah, it's actually a good time to break. Let me just tell you what we are going to do in the next part, and I'm actually probably going to switch to slides for this part so that we can use this awesome, and you don't have to read my handwriting. So what we're going to do, we're going to fill that last column. So let me just summarize the thing. Sorry, I'll just take 2 minutes just so that we have the thing. So here we're going to do, even using different color, we can have local randomness exists, but weak secrets. So here we assume, listen, the secret key is still comes from a weak source. Maybe it's my fingerprint, or maybe it was uniform, but the attacker leaked something about it. So Krzysztof will talk about leakage-resilient cryptography. So we have perfect randomness, but for whatever reason, our secret key is still weak. Can we do stuff? And the answer will be yes, dramatic yes. So we will be able to do all those things. But surprisingly, the questions that we are going to do, there are many questions in this setting. It's a huge area. So in fact, I told you maybe like 4 or 5 papers of mine. So in terms of kind of you know, the field of information theoretic security and randomness extraction. So this is essentially my work, which I talked about it here. And more or less, I'm the only one who is working in this area for whatever reason. Hopefully, some of you will like it. You know, majority of my papers and most of the papers of other speakers is like here. And this is like is essentially this guy over here. So this is really kind of the mainstream thing. And it's super exciting because things become possible. And here the goal is to do things as efficiently as possible, not in terms of the speed, but in terms of entropy consumption. We want to extract as much, you know, randomness or to derive as long of a secret key as possible from what we do. So here, we are kind of from possibility to impossibility, we are shifting to a different mode of being greedy. And essentially, what I'm going to talk about there is one particular aspect where there were like a lot of surprises here in terms of like key derivation functions. And somewhat similar here, the difference between key derivation and randomness extraction. So I will kind of show that it's not necessary to do this application. It's not necessary to first extract a key and then just use these check marks. You can actually do much better if you directly work with a weak source in question. But local randomness essentially is of critical help and goes from impossibility land to possibility land. For example, the kind of, I'll take it there. And there are lots and lots of applications of this kind of thing. So it's a very exciting area. Right. Yes.
What lies at the other extreme of the...
I mean, I didn't go so far. I don't know what it goes from secret sharing. Well, of course, in general, I mean, becomes a little bit esoteric. That's why this paper, I think it has only like one citation. Krzysztof can check if it has more. I mean, it's kind of interesting questions, but a little bit esoteric. I think extraction is kind of fundamental philosophical thing. You know, what kind of randomness is needed for different applications? Do I need more for secret sharing than for encryptions and for commitment? I mean, it's a little bit kind of technical and people don't find it that natural. So I don't know what is the guy inside. What is interesting to me conceptually is there something here for which I can have a meaningful separation? Not like one n log n separation, because nobody cares, you know, you care about encrypting more than log n bits, but something where you can do a privacy on, you know, I don't know, like square root of n bits, but you cannot extract even one bit. So I don't know, if you can come up with a privacy primitive anything, it might be even artificial, I would find it very interesting. I mean, if it's actually even natural, like a secret sharing scheme, well, that would be great. So conceptually, I don't know what lies here. So far, what we know, at least for natural classes, they're all the same. It's like, you know, it's like nothing is possible in the sense that for natural classes, nothing is possible. But once you start to define artificial things, but things are possible, like taking a scheme and say, my sources, all distributions, so each scheme is secure. These are like artificial things. I don't know if there are like this natural separation. I think that would be great conceptually, even if it's super artificial. If you can give me a privacy application, not like authentication application where a lot of things are possible, but really something where the attacker cannot distinguish like zero from one or something like that, or any messages for which there exists a separation and the message domain has to be big, not just like one bit, I think that would be super interesting conceptually. This is definitely open.
Is there anything about hardest assumptions? For example, does the EDH hold if you don't have good randomness?
Which hold? EDH. No, I mean, I haven't looked at this direction. The only place where I've seen this, Riemann hypothesis or something, is like for some of the de-randomization results where we choose something at random and you can say under some assumptions if you take the smallest prime as opposed to random or something like that. So it was only used non, you know, kind of to de-randomize some particular construction, like about your criticism over here. But yeah, I haven't seen any kind of conditional results. And definitely, at least what I described here in this flavor, I described it kind of as an information theoretic thing. Whether there exists something interesting and meaningful computational among this. So as I said, the results, the positive result on separation, they work even for computational encryption and so on. I'm not sure if there is something deeper where, you know, making computational assumptions of pseudo-randomness can help us separate those things. So far, all the results that I showed, let's say encryption implies extraction. If you talk about computational setting, you'll say computationally secure encryption implies extraction of pseudo-random bits. But because, you know, for a pseudo-random bit, any particular bit is perfectly random, at least at the level of one bit, it's statistical. But at the level of like b minus log n bits, this will be pseudo-random. So far, everything you said extends, and it's almost trivial. The non-trivial, slightly non-trivial part is this efficiency thing. But that's what I'm saying. That's why this red part was kind of nice, that this extractor prime, we could make it efficient, so we could maintain efficiency. Efficient extraction, efficient encryption implies efficient extraction. But yeah, so I think this was kind of a good summary. But so after lunch, we'll completely switch gears and talk about, I think, you know, I really like this line of work, but things where from being hopeless, we are becoming super greedy, and we are trying to minimize entropy loss and stuff.